Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Mr. Sutton, if you'll give the invocation for please.
Yes, if we could take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another day as we enter into a new calendar year, 2011. Isn't it beautiful? We all should think it's beautiful that 2,000 and some years after the birth of Jesus Christ that we are still worshiping his name. And help us to realize that we can only go backwards in a few areas, one especially asking for our forgiveness of our misdeeds. Help us in the future to realize that to ask for your forgiveness, to ask for your support, that we can solve the world's problems, but not until we have your blessings. Help our military all across the world as it protects our freedoms, to help us to conduct tonight's business and all the business of this year as we should, and make it be in the sense of what's pleasing to your sight. Amen.
Amen. Okay. I do have a public comment from Raymond Cooper. If you'll come forward, please, and state your name. Hey, how are you?
Good, how are you? This is the first I've ever been here, so what is the protocol?
Well, under public comments, you can just comment about whatever it is that you feel like you need to talk about.
I am here on behalf of Grace Healthcare Management Corporation from Chattanooga, Tennessee. We're here with the acquiring the lease of the Kindred facility. And my travels with Grace Healthcare, I've been employed there for a little over a year. A very heartfelt, warming company that represents our residents and staff very well. They believe in dedication, sincere compassion, and providing good care for skilled service residents. They have, actually, my building is an acquired Kindred building. It was acquired in January of 2008. During the course of that acquisition, they have continued to improve the physical plan of the facility. We have increased the revenues of that facility. I think there were some questions actually pertaining to the paperwork that was submitted that made reference to the insurance provider there also. I don't think the CEO and president have had an opportunity to review the run loss statements on that. But once it has been reviewed and compared, they will adjust that to the industry standards. I think the physical plant question came up in that also, and that we have not had the opportunity to see the physical facility that's wanted to be acquired with the lease. However, once we've had the opportunity to tour that facility and make the noted notations that need to be upgraded from a physical standpoint, they will be done, i.e. painting, any physical constructions that need to be repaired or replaced. I know Grace is very big on their color scheme, so they will repair that inside and out. Also, the beautification of the landscaping with additional pictures as well. So.
Okay. Now, this is about the lease that we have.
It's on our agenda.
If anybody would like to ask any questions, or should we wait and Mr. Honeycutt?
Probably wait until we get to the point where we have that on the agenda.
Choice, okay. All right, well, thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
And enjoy your stay.
Thanks.
Okay, are there any commissioner comments at this point? Okay, we'll get them all later. Okay, Ms. Becky Lowy, if you will come forward, it's time for the annual financial report.
Good evening. Appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight and to go over this information with you. You all should have received in your packet a set of graphs. Hopefully this will allow us to look at the financial picture in a little easier way than the financial statement. I will start by saying that you did have an unqualified opinion. That means that when we look at the process for accumulating the data and all the transactions, that we did not see any issues with how that data is accumulated. So we believe once that goes into the financial presentation, the financial statement, it's fairly presenting your financial position. And so what we do is, in an audit, we look at those policies and procedures and we test them. We make sure they're operating the way they need to. And so our opinion is that the financial statements do fairly present your financial position. I'm going to start with the first graph. The first graph is of your general fund. This is on the modified accrual basis. And so that is real close to what you operate on a monthly basis. You use a budgetary basis, which is closer to the cash basis. In an audit, we're required to actually do year-end accruals, which capture all the information that occurs in July and August that actually happened or is applicable to June or the months before the end of the year. And so we have to pull those resources back into the current year, which is the 2010 year. And so when you get that sales tax payment in July, that's going to go back into June 30th. And so as we look at this, I just want you to keep that in mind. The revenues for this year were $120 million. Last year, $124.5 million. So you had a $4 million decrease in your revenue for the current year. Your expenditures, $126.5 million compared to $127.5 million for last year. So $1 million decrease in your expenditures. I've got a lot of notes here. I'm not going to go over all of them, but I want to hit the highlights on what caused those changes. Your taxes actually went up $1 million, which is good. Federal and state revenue went up $1 million. Offsetting that is your local option sales tax. That was a decrease of $6 million. And so that makes up your $4 million deficit, mostly in your sales tax. You also have a decrease in your interest. I just have to say that because I'm going to look at some four-year information, and the impact on your interest has actually been very significant. The change this year from last year was $195,000. If we look at your expenditures, your general government went down by $181,000. That is mostly due to the revaluation. You didn't have as many expenditures in 2010 as you did in 2009. You also had decreases across the board. We've all heard about containing costs and how you can cut costs and manage costs. And so we do see that in a lot of the accounts as we go down the road. We see a lot of decreases in those numbers. That is offset by the $550,000 that was spent on the old school property. That is also in this amount. So you had a decrease, but you had a $550,000 increase because you had that large capital outlay. So the decreases are reflective of what I think you were trying to do when you're looking at that budget and those costs. Your public safety went down by $403,000. That's mainly in one item, and that's your jail. Your jail expenditures actually went down by $403,000. Your economic and physical development went up by $174,000. But 240 of that is in one single incentive. And so you had decreases in the other expenses, and then that offsets with that increase. Human services went down by 1.4, and that is mostly due to the Medicaid, the drop in the Medicaid. Education went up 730,000. Most of that is with the ABSS school system. Your debt service went up by 272,000. So all those together are what account for the decrease in your expenditures. Now, what I said mostly was increases. What those items that I highlighted are the single items. So you had a lot of single item increases. You had a few single item decreases, but then you had a lot of decreases that were just across the board. And so that speaks to the fact that you've tried to manage those costs. I commend you on that. The result ends up being is a deficit still of $3.9 million, which is not good. When I look at this and I try to figure out what do you do, what I'm telling my clients right now, I'm a CPA. I have a lot of clients that are trying to operate businesses. What we're seeing is when you have a short-term issue, you cut cost, you manage cost. Everybody can do that. You cut out going out to eat, you cut out whatever you can. In your business, your personal, everybody's had to do that. It looks like you all have done that. Managed your projects, managed what opportunities you felt like you needed to take care of or take advantage of. But also, we see a lot of line items that have gone down in cost. And so you've managed those expenses. That's a short-term answer. when you get into a long-term situation where you continue to have decreases in your revenue, it kind of changes the whole picture. And so I went back and looked at over the last 4 years, from really the beginning of this recession to where we are right now, to look at what the overall changes have been in your revenue. Your taxes have gone up by $5 million. Positive position for your taxes. Most of that, of course, would be due to the valuation and the changes in that. Local option sales tax has gone down by almost $10 million. Your jail has gone up in revenue by $6.5 million. You got to remember, there's an offsetting cost to that, but you still had an increase in that revenue. Your federal and state grant money went up by $3 million. All of those, you actually ended up with a $2.3 million increase over the last 4 years. So your revenue still went up, but your expenditures in total over the last 4 years have also gone up significantly. And so you've got to look at the whole picture. And what I, when I look at this year to last year, and really the last 3 years on trying to manage that, the expenditures, you've been able to do that, but you're going to have to continue to do that. Your fund balance right now is not where it needs to be. And when you look at the, you know, the 8% rule is what we've always talked about, and you're at 12.6%. That's a decrease of 2% from last year. And so long term, it changes the picture. And I know you all know that because you're dealing with the budget and dealing with where the expenses are. If I look, the single one item is the sales tax. That's the one single item of decrease that you're having to deal with. Your high to where you are right now is an almost $11 million decrease. And so that is one very large piece of lost revenue. And so as you move forward, you're going to have to continue. I know you've looked at every possible place to cut the expenses. You're going to have to continue to do that and look for those opportunities, but I think you're going to have to look at the revenue also and look at what can be done through the revenue. Hopefully we'll see some influx in the sales tax with Tanger coming and with the property tax there as well. Hopefully we'll see some influx there, but I think you're going to have to really look at that and try to figure out how to reverse this trend. You know, I hear about economic, the recession being over and things changing and getting better. I think they are in some places, in some areas we do see improvement, but because it's become long-term now, it's going to really require you to look at every option that you have on the revenue side and the expenditure side. I also wanted to, I told you about the interest. Your total interest this year, it decreased by $195,000. Your total interest for every fund was $135,000. 4 years ago, it was $2.7 million. So you are not only dealing with you had the sales tax, you knew that was going to happen. You also have a really large hole in your interest that I don't think people really expected to see. And so there's nothing you can really do about that, but you do have to look at that deficit as well because you've lost, or that loss of revenue, that revenue's gone. And we certainly haven't seen any recovery in that at this point. And so that's another piece that you have. Now, one good thing to look at are your taxes. Your taxes over the last 4 years have gone up by $5 million. Between last year and this year, $1 million. If I look at your valuation as of June 30th, 2010, it's $12.2 billion. That's the value of property in Alamance County. Last year it was $10.8 billion. So you have increased the value of the property in Alamance County by 13%. And so that's very positive. Of course, that's through the revaluation and that's taken place. And so we expected to see that increase, but
that's
I do.
That's only on paper. That's only on paper. I don't think I could sell my home for what is on the tax books for it.
So at this point, that's an interesting position that we're in with the economy the way it is.
Yeah.
You're right. I think most of us would probably be in that same position. So my hope is, as I've said the last couple of years, is that we'll see all of that recover. But, you know, we really haven't seen that. And that's what really bothers me right now, is because until we see a few more of the pieces start to recover, we're going to continue to have holes where they're not being filled. And so I agree with you. I think we right now we're not in good times, and I think that's what's being reflected here. So when you look at that, 1 cent on the tax rate is $1.2 million in revenue. I know that's a big issue when you look at the budget every year. What is the tax rate going to be? $1.2 million is what you generate for every cent on the tax rate. Our tax rate right now is 52 per hundred. It was 58 for the last 2 years. And so that's a piece I'm sure you'll have to look at, and I'm sure you'll have to consider where you need to set that. So as I look at revenue, I wish it was a little more positive, but I do think there are a couple things. You do have an increase in your value, and so that is an opportunity. You also, we know of some things that hopefully will increase your sales tax with Tanger coming. Hopefully that will see an increase in your sales tax from that. And so you do have a couple of spots where hopefully we'll see some revenue coming in, but you're in a tough position. And I think everybody, all my meetings have been this way because it's become long-term, and it changes the way you manage it when it becomes long-term.
Before you switch,
yes.
That page from 2007 to 2010, sales tax went 26.4 to 16.7. How much of that gap is the Medicaid swap out?
Cent.
I don't have that figure.
The state, yeah. State was taking the money.
Of the, what's the total difference?
For Medicaid, the swap out is about 6.5.
Okay, so more than half of the difference, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that's what a lot of people don't understand as far as where the money went. It's not as much sales has
decreased that much.
Yeah, decreased
right.
That much. It was the state compromise on
Medicaid.
Medicaid.
Mm-hmm.
Which is maybe smoke and mirrors, but still.
It's still gone.
Well, when you look at that decrease, the change, if you take that out of there, out of that change, that makes it a little bit less of a gap there. I don't think Tanger will fill that gap, but at least you're not trying to fill an $11 million gap.
Not to give excuses, but I think that's a stat that people...
I agree.
Becky, you may have said this, but down under the other financing sources that help close that gap from $6.2 million down to $3.9 million, what is the 2.2? Because that's the largest, looks like it has been over your time horizon. It may not be just one item.
It's not. It's several items.
But it seems to be larger than previous years.
The other financing sources and uses that you have in your general fund, they're transfers from other funds. It's project money that goes in and out. Depending on how your projects are being funded, the general fund sometimes fronts that money,
so
and so it's
timing issues.
Mm-hmm, just timing issues on that, and that's $2.2 million.
Yeah. Craig, do you have any idea how the sales tax is coming for this fiscal year?
We're down. There was a large refund that we had at the beginning of the year, which was about $1 million. However, we just got the sales tax for December, which is October sales tax, and that was up about $40,000
from October of last year.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so just for the month,
for the month. Mm-hmm. Yes,
the page that you're looking at, most of you, the 1A. I'm not going to go over that, but I'll just give you a little bit of explanation on that. In trying to figure out where we were and all of the factors that you're dealing with, I felt like this would be beneficial for you to have a 10-year trend with as much detail as I could give you without it being overly cumbersome. The yellow is just items to look at, trends that I felt like were significant for you to look at. The other colors actually go together. So when you look at restricted intergovernmental, that's your grant money. But you also have an expense there. So if you see an increase in that revenue, you want to look at the expense and what happened with the expense. And that's the way that form was developed. And so you can see a 10-year history and follow the trends on what revenue and expenditures have done. If you have any specific questions on those, I'll be glad to try to answer them, but that's really just for your information so that you could have something that you could look at and get a 10-year snapshot. That is modified accrual as well, which means it's almost what you manage on. What we have to pull in are the current resources, which means the July and August that you get is pulled in, but it's not full accrual, it's just modified. So we're capturing a little bit of additional information that you don't actually receive in cash, but actually goes back into the previous year. On page 2, I'm actually going to give you an amended graph on this.
Thank you.
I think you'll like this graph a little bit better. What we had on the original graph was the information that we had originally received from the engineer. We have to actually do a calculation with numbers from your engineer who looks at compaction, capacity, airspace, all these numbers. They go into a formula and we have to calculate what the post-closure estimated cost is. It's what we think the cost is going to be with the engineers, all their technical numbers on compaction and capacity put into a formula that gives us what the expected cost is going to be to close that landfill. When we originally got those numbers, it was discovered on into the process that we did not have the final numbers. We did not have the correct numbers. And so we've redone that calculation. Your financial statements, you actually don't have your financial statements at this point. They are also being redone because it is a material difference on the calculation. And so that's why I said you'd like this graph better, because it's a much lower cost. What we actually ended up with was $8.5 million in that estimated cost compared to over $10 million. And so a much more favorable position for the landfill fund. And so I apologize for that amended graph, but it is a much better picture for the landfill fund. Okay, if we look at the revenue, your revenue this year is $3.5 million compared to $3.6 million. That's a $124,000 decrease, so pretty even between the 2 years on the income. The expenditures went up by $561,000, and that is all mostly in the post-closure cost. It still was more than last year, but not quite as high as we had started out with. You also had a decrease in the interest in this fund of $110,000. That's going to affect every fund that you have. And so the excess is $217,000. If I look at that and compare it to last year, you had $1 million excess. This year you have $217,000. And so you take all of the pieces, the decrease in revenue, the increase in the post-closure cost, and a decrease in interest, they all have a negative impact. When we do accruals at the end of the year, we want to see where things offset, not create negatives for you. But when you look at all of these changes, all of these issues that are affecting your revenue, they're all negative. That's not always the case, but in this particular year, it is the case. But you still end up with a positive number there, which is great, because you know that means that this fund is being managed. The goal of any kind of proprietary fund is for it to operate like a business and at least break even. And so because you have been able to do that over all these years, you have a strong fund balance in that fund. Right now it's at about $5 million. You have cash in the fund of 13, but you take out that large liability we just talked about, and that leaves you about 5. And so you still have a strong fund balance in the landfill fund. This is full accrual, okay? The landfill fund is required to be recorded on full accrual, so that's what you're looking at here. On a modified accrual, which is what the budgetary basis, your excess was actually $1.3 million. So the accruals do impact the end of the year and the numbers that you're looking at. But I wanted to tell you that, because that does speak to the fact that the fund is being managed very well. Last year was $800,000. The year before that was $1.2 million. And so that fund is being managed. There are, on full accrual, what happens is with the accruals, you put all the accruals in, because it's full accrual, it's not modified, so all the accruals go in here. So that means whatever money you have due to you is going to go in as revenue. Whatever you owe out is going to go in as an expenditure. And so this is exactly where the fund would be if you closed the door on June 30th and did not do any other transactions. This is exactly where this fund would end up. And so very positive on the management of this fund. The post-closure cost does tend to go up and down sometimes, depending on how many acres have been opened and things like that. There's a lot of different calculations that the engineers do, so there is some fluctuation in that. But even with that, the fund has still been very positive. And as long as I've been working on this audit, it always has been. And I think that that I commend management on that, on being able to manage that fund so well. If you look at the next graph, this is your employee insurance fund. The revenue actually went down by $711,000. The expenditures went up $426,000. what I want to draw your attention to is back in 2005. If you see the trend, we had, I didn't like the having to report that the trend was so negative for this fund, because this again is a break-even fund. It's got to cover, the revenue has to cover the expenses. And so what the county did was they said, okay, let's look at these, look at this fund, and how can we make this fund a stronger fund? Your fund balance at the low was $830,000. With expenditures of $6.9 million, $830,000 is just not very much. And so you took a pretty aggressive position on getting this fund into a much better shape. Right now the fund balance is $8 million. And so now you're actually in the position where you can manage those revenues, manage the premiums, and you've done that. You've looked at the premiums and adjusted in the current in this year, and I know you're looking at that again. Your fund balance is where it needs to be. You can now go forward and manage this on a break-even basis, revenues equaling expenditures. And so very positive position for that fund. Same thing for the workers' compensation fund. Revenues are almost exactly the same. Expenditures are up a little bit, $111,000. But again, if you look back, the trend was not so good. Now the trend is actually much more positive, and you've been able to grow that fund balance as well. The low was $336,000 in the fund balance. Right now it's $1.6 million. So again, you've managed that fund very well. You've corrected a low fund balance. You've put that in a much stronger position. And so going forward, this is another piece where you can manage the premiums against the expenditures and look for that to break even. That's your goal, is to break those even. Page five, I've changed a little bit. I thought that in the past that graph was a little bit confusing to follow, so I've changed this a little bit. It's still just information for you to be able to look at. When you look at expenditures, you know, you kind of think, okay, what's my budget? So I've got the budget on here, the expenditures on here. Your history has always been that you spend less than what you budget. And now that's even better position to be in than even in the past, because when you look at those expenditures, if you had spent $136 million, you would be in not be in a very good position right now. And so that's a good way. It does build in some room for what you've got going on. Can we do this project? You have that in your budget, and so it allows you to consider what needs to be done. But again, to me, that shows that you're managing that fund. The other columns are your fund balance. When you talk about fund balance, there's lots of numbers to look at. And so I wanted you to have the pieces of that fund balance so that you could understand a little bit more about how the calculations are done. When we look at that 8% expenditure, that is your general fund to your available fund balance. Okay, that's your total expenditures to your available fund balance. You've got to have at least 8% of your expenditures in fund balance. Right now you're at 12.6. And so you still have more than the 8% minimum, but it has gone down. Like I said, 2 points from last year. The box down in the middle is actually some comparisons. We looked at Alamance County for 910, 12.6. Then we looked at where you were last year. The comparable information is only available for 8-9. The 10 is not available yet. And so we're looking at kind of where your position was last year, so you can at least have some kind of comparable there. Alamance County was at 4.23. The four counties that are listed there are the ones that we felt like were most similar to you all. And so what we've listed is the tax rate, and don't forget, this is 8.9, and so that's why it's 58. The collection percentage, the tax collection percentage, which does exclude vehicles, and the 8% calculation, what that percentage is. And you see how you compare to those. Counties statewide are 20.6%. Counties over 100,000, 19.33%. The 10 counties that are just closest to your size, not necessarily the most similar to you, but closest to your size, are 21.64. And so your percentage is low. And I as you go forward in this budget year, I would keep that in mind. I would hope that you would not be in the same position next year, because you will eventually get down to where you're not meeting that 8% minimum. And the LGC would come in and look at that. They would come in and ask you questions about it and look at what your plan is for correcting that. So,
you say one
yes.
thing about And I think we're on that track this year as far as the amount of fund balance that we're projecting, or not, that we're not going to use, that we could. But you take Davidson County, for instance. Tim and I went down and met with them over performance-based budgeting about 2 years ago. I looked at the guy and I said, how did y'all get your fund balance that high? And he just kind of grinned. And I said, I know how you did it. You had reevaluation, you didn't cut taxes. And he grinned even bigger. And I said, third question, I said, how in the world did you pull that off? And he said they were able to convince the public that, you know, they'd have the money when they wanted to do something. But they had reevaluation and didn't cut taxes a penny, not one penny. So it's kind of false in a way as to success as far as why theirs is that high. I mean, we could have pulled that same stunt. I mean, that was a stunt down there. And Randolph's probably not far away from that same explanation. They haven't cut taxes there as much as they should have. So your fund balance does grow, you know, at times as a result of excessive taxes, and it does get spent with excessive spending. I will buy that, but, you know, I don't think, I think the whole story needs to be told. And if I'm not mistaken, I think our fund balance is equal, greater than Wake County's as far as a percentage of their budget. And it's pretty much equal to New Hanover, which is a very high tax county. And if I'm not mistaken, it's higher than Orange County's, if I'm not mistaken. Is that all correct? I'm pretty sure that's right. But not to give excuses, but I think, you know, there's good comparisons to look at all across the board. But definitely Davidson County is a good point in case is why theirs is as high as it is.
And that's what makes your job so difficult. It is very hard to try to manage all of those people.
It's hard to get apples to apples, true apples to apples.
I will say that your collection percentage is on the far right, and that is, the last couple years have been the worst in the years that are shown here. And I do think that when you have revaluation, especially, you know, we had a difficult revaluation, and so that takes a lot of time, and sometimes the follow-up doesn't happen because you don't have the staff to do it, and I'm not, you know, I feel like that's probably a piece of this, and as you go forward, all that's done behind you, you can now concentrate on those collections. You have somebody in place that I believe will do that, and so hopefully you'll see that go up as well. And so that will hopefully be another piece that will make your position a little more positive. You know, one of the things that the LGC will look at is, can you pay your debt? And you do have a lot of debt, but you can pay your debt. And so I don't think there's cause for concern at this point. I just think I'm probably going to tell you what you already know. You're going to have to continue to really look at how you're going to manage the revenue and the expenditures. It's the whole system now, and that's when it's short term, you can just look at expenses and say, I can defer this, I can cut this, and you can manage it that way. But when it's short term, you almost have to look at every single line item that you're dealing with. And so I commend you for what you've been able to do, because you have kept it, you have reacted to it. The worst thing is when you do nothing, you don't look at cost, you don't do anything, you just let things happen as they do. It's obvious just by looking at my trial balance that with all the decreases that you've tried to do that, some opportunities have come up that you felt like you needed to take advantage of. Well, still, that's managing what you have. And so I commend you for that and just encourage you to continue to do that. Okay, the last thing I want to go over, those are all the numbers. And so if you have any questions as we go finish up, just let me know. The only comment that you had this year was an over-budget comment. When we do the year-end accruals, one of the things we look at is the leases. We talked about leases last year, and we've corrected some of the issues with the leases, but one of the issues is that when the lease expense is budgeted, if the lease is determined to be capital, it has to be budgeted as debt service instead of as lease expense. And it was budgeted as lease expense again. And so that is one issue that we will certainly be glad to help Amy with and kind of go through that process. It is a little bit of a complicated consideration to determine whether they're capital or operating. And the way you've budgeted is they've gone in just as lease expense. But if they are capital, they do have to go into debt service. And we cannot move your budget. The budget can only be adjusted by board approval. And so it was budgeted. It was budgeted. It was just not budgeted in debt service. And so that's a comment that I hate to make, but that we are required anytime you're over budget, it has to be a comment in your financial statements. And so we're required to say that, but the issue is not that it wasn't budgeted, it was just not budgeted as debt service.
Were they were the assets budgeted as assets, the capital assets, since it was a capitalized lease?
They're budgeted as lease expense.
Oh, I understand that, but on the balance, so they're not on the balance sheet.
All of that is part of the information that we actually go through at the end of the year.
So it should be on the balance sheet as well?
That's a piece of it that we actually do. So that's kind of an accrual piece, because on a budgetary basis, you're going to put that on as expense. And so that's one of the year-end accounting changes that we would do, or journal entries that we would do. I will say that we did not have any comments for DSS. And so I commend Susan and her staff for that. We did have a couple of things that were just minor management letter items that we just communicated with her, but no comments for this year. And so I've told you all along that they do a very good job with their systems, and they have good systems in place. And so we didn't have any comments this year, and I just felt like I needed to say that. So I commend Susan for her efforts on that. The last thing you have in your graphs are a letter that goes to the council, to the commissioners, and this just basically says that we audit under generally government auditing standards and OMB A133, which is your federal and state compliance. And so we do audit you at the highest level. So when we talk about DSS, we are looking at a lot of things. We get a lot of files out, we look at a lot of pieces of information, and that is through your federal and state grant money. That's where those requirements come in. And so we do audit at that higher level. We look at the policies, as I said, make sure they're operating as they should. We also look at the estimates. One of the things that we look at is the landfill. And so that's one of your biggest ones. And obviously, as we've talked about, it can be a number that moves up and down. So we look at that. We unfortunately do have to rely on the engineer's information, and so that was where we had an issue this year. But we also have the emergency management services. The accounts receivable for that are also one big piece. If you look at the report for that, you're going to see a big number, but that's not. It's the letter, the second page.
Oh.
I'm sorry, I did not page number those. The second page right after that one.
Okay.
That second. We actually look at the EMS receivables and book them as the historical collection percentage has been, because you can't put a big asset on there if it's not really collectible. That would be a misleading number. And so that's the other large item that we actually look at. We did not have any difficulties in performing the audit. The corrected and uncorrected misstatements, this is talking about journal entries. I've talked about journal entries some, and we do the accrual journal entries. And so at the end of the year, what you give us is a cash basis set of records. And so we look at the journal entries. The data is all captured through systems of the county that are set up, and we actually get those journal entries into the financial information. We look at those journal entries to make sure that they don't indicate that there's an issue somewhere. If we're correcting things, that could be an indication of an issue. If we're just doing accruals, that's just a normal year-end accrual. And so that is not indication of a problem. And so we do look at those to make sure we don't get a sense that the information is not being captured correctly. And we did not have that conclusion in looking at those journal entries. We did not have any disagreements with management, and we do get a representation from management that says that the information they've provided to us is accurate and reflects the financial position. And so with that, what you have left in your packet is the Local Government Commission's memo. That is not my memo. That is a memo from the LGC that just gives you some of the information. Where I was talking about the comparables, this has a lot of information in it that you can look at and compare the county to whoever you would like to. I also would tell you that the North Carolina Treasurer's website actually has a new tool out that will allow you to go in and compare yourself to five other counties and lots of different criteria. And so I encourage you, if you're interested in looking at least the raw numbers, there's no explanation there, but at least the raw numbers of comparable information, you can do that on the Treasurer's website. I certainly appreciate the opportunity to go over this with you. And as you go through, once you get your completed financial statement, if you have any questions, I'll be glad to try to answer them. I'm available at any time. So if anything comes up that I can help you with, I'll sure be glad to.
Anybody got any questions? Thank you. No questions?
Very informative.
Thank you.
Thank you, Becky. Okay. The next thing that we're going to do is
set a public hearing for the Redway renaming. Do you guys have all that information on that? Are there any questions about that? If not, do I hear a motion that we set the public hearing for February the 7th, 2011 at our next meeting?
So moved.
Have a motion and...
Second.
Second, do I, everybody in favor say aye?
Aye.
Aye, all opposed? Next thing is the update on cable television, and if Mr. Dave Harris will come forward.
Madam Chairman and...
Yes, sir.
Board members, pleasure to be here this evening in Alamance County. I'm David Harris. I'm the cable television administrator in this region. And I've been doing this for a long time, and rules change every once in a while. So let me just give you a little information about how we got where we are today, just to bring you up to speed. You entered into a franchise agreement with Time Warner Cable, which expired in December of 2009. State law, specifically the North Carolina Video Service Competition Act of 2006, I'm just going to call it the Act in the future here, that redirects the authority over video to the state. So you lost all power in 2006 to deal with cable television. The state approves, serves as the regulatory authority over video franchises. This law allows the county-held franchises to remain intact, which yours did, until such time as there's either competition or your franchise expires, and the cable operator can then apply for a state franchise agreement, which did happen in December of 2009. That's about where we are right now. Let me just talk about revenue, because we've been talking about revenue here. The revenue for your franchise agreement is given to you on a quarterly basis by the state. It's based on your revenue in 2006, and it's on a formula based on that 2006 revenue. And I think your revenue from July last year to June 2010 was about $193,000. You did lose some revenue when Time Warner received their state franchise agreement, because up to that time, the state was paying you a franchise fee of 7% through the formula. And at that time, you had a franchise agreement with Time Warner, and they were paying you some amount of money on franchise fees. That was a technicality, and the bill allowed you to collect that franchise fee. When Time Warner applied for the state franchise agreement, that all went away. Now the North Carolina Video the Act has state franchises passed to the state. That includes adherence to all franchise agreements with the state. So the state is the person who has a responsibility to enforce those franchise agreements. Cable complaints are the responsibility of the state attorney general's office. I would tell you right up front that if a citizen in this county calls up and has a cable complaint, that your manager is going to call me, and we're going to solve that cable complaint on a local level. We're not going to ask a citizen to call the state attorney general's office. So that's kind of where we are right now on cable. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Can you give a little background on that 2006 act? What was the official name of it? Because I've asked for some information out of our local legislator's office. I couldn't get anything.
Who did you ask for information?
I'd rather not get into it.
Oh, okay.
No, it was a state legislator's office.
Okay. Well, it's called the North Carolina Video Services Competition Act.
Say it again. North Carolina Video
Services Competition Act. And I'll send you a copy of it.
Yeah, I'd like to see it.
It's called 2006-151. I'll send you a copy. And whatever you'd like to know, it's in here.
That was voted on by the state legislature and all that.
they probably would not be aware of some of the things that are going on with the Cable Act because it's mostly handled now by the Department of Revenue. And so we used to charge 5% franchise fee, which you all received. When the state took it over, they went to 7%, but you still collect basically 5% of the 2006 rates.
See, I didn't realize that we got the $193,000.
Well, I'm not standing on those numbers, but I did look at Department of Revenue today, and that's what they said they paid you. You might want to follow up on that one.
What about rate increases and so forth? How's that negotiated out?
There's no negotiation on rates. Yeah, you know, in 1992, when you and I started all this, regional cable administration at the Council of Governments, at that time, you, as the franchise authority, had some ability to negotiate rates. Then we had the cable acts that came in, three of them in a row, that just eroded that all the way. That's a federal cable act. Eroded all of those rights that you have. It got down to all we were doing was auditing the rates that Time Warner was charging, and they would give us multitudes of forms, which I would go over and send you info copies saying they're charging the right rate under federal law. And that's about where we ended up until the state took this over. Now, Mr. Yarborough is here from Time Warner, if you'd like to ask him any questions about rates. I'm sure he would love to talk about it.
Let me ask you this question. If you turn on our Channel 5, and again, I know we don't have any control over this, but if we are getting funds, and if it is under a government umbrella, and we're part of the government, you know, I think it's worthy to have some discussion. If I turn on Channel 5 here in Burlington, it really, in my opinion, is kind of a weak presentation. I mean, it's a lime green, very faded. It's really just almost.
Is that the government access channel?
That's 5.
Yeah, pretty weak.
Public access. I think it's pretty bad, frankly, for the rates that people are paying.
It's really not. I don't believe it's a public access channel. It's a community channel.
Yeah, it's rated here as a community channel.
Right.
If I go over to Greensboro, and I was over there this weekend, and just for the heck of it, hit the cable box channel 18, public access, and then went down to government access. I can't see it as far as, I think it's 13. They were very professional, very clear. And is there a difference in the communities as far as what the public has?
Well, Greensboro and Guilford County both get video. They get funds from the state to run those channels. They also have professional people who are running those channels. And I don't know what the hookup between Time Warner and Guilford County and Greensboro is. Pretty much a solid link.
So you're saying it's not just Time Warner?
I don't know, but I think you should ask that question to Mr. Yarborough.
Okay. Well, he's heard the question.
Okay. And I'll take the podium.
Dave is absolutely correct. That's a government access channel. And what we do is provide the bandwidth for the channel, but we don't operate it. So if there's some concerns about the quality of the channel, then it needs to be addressed to the city that's operating it or the county that's operating it. You mentioned Greensboro, and Dave is absolutely correct. They spend operating funds out of their budget for professional studio and professional people to run it. And again, it's the same thing. All we do is provide the channel. We don't operate the channel. We have no control over what's on the channel or really the quality of the channel. We provide the bandwidth to deliver the channel.
Well, who's doing 5 for us?
I believe that's out of Burlington. Well, they have a facility inside City Hall, I believe.
That's where Channel 5 comes from?
Yes, sir.
I certainly didn't know that. I haven't been told that. I don't believe that's... See, back before, used to have the radio station on. Mm-hmm. And you had thousands of people in the community that had cable listening to a certain radio station.
WBAG.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And it was very nicely done. The audio was good. The the way they put announcements on was good, and so forth. And then it was taken off, and the excuse was, well, copyright or...
Not an excuse, that's a fact.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, we had a complaint from another local FM station on why is that particular station getting preference. And it is true. There are copyright issues involved with rebroadcasting a radio station. This has happened in Greensboro and in Thomasville and several other places. And not only is it an issue of maybe the government showing preference to one particular radio station, it's also an issue of having to pay ASCAP and BMI copyrights. And that could be an issue for Time Warner Cable as well as the government, as the county, because you have to pay for the right to rebroadcast that stuff. Most governments that have gone to either paying for Muzak, you know what Muzak is, it's canned music, and the copyright is included in that fee, or they use background music that's called in the public domain, so there's no copyright connected with it. They're not protected. It's in the public domain. So it's a very real consideration. Copyright is not just an excuse. It's a very real consideration.
Well, an excuse is not necessarily a negative, detrimental commentary on what I was told. Another issue is I went into a local cable to pay a cable bill.
Yes, sir.
And I was asked for phone numbers to how do I call and ask these questions. Mm-hmm. And it was not readily available to me. And the person couldn't find phone numbers. And she came back. She said, well, you can go online. And I told her, well, I didn't have a computer. And it was just a problem even getting a phone number out of them. But my last question is I asked them about channel C-SPAN. You had on your basic cable C-SPAN 1 and C-SPAN 2.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and 38 was C-SPAN 2, and you took C-SPAN 2 off.
And we moved it, yes, sir.
Yeah, I asked a question about that at the local cable office, and they said they didn't know what was taken off, and I said, oh, you can get it if you get digital. And I said, asked them, well, you know, are you using that as a lost leader? In other words, you're trying to entice people to get digital by saying you'll get C-SPAN 2 as part of it. Why? I'm just... You know, and I'm trying to be respectful here, but, you know, when Time Warner, in my opinion, when cable came into Alamance County, it was they were going to do so much for us. They were going to show live programs, live ball games, live functions, and so on. And it just never came true, it appeared to me. And the only thing that you show that I see are taped things that people send you, taped or DVDs or whatever. And it's gone to Raleigh, and now we can't seem to. I just think, you know, Time Warner could give us a whole lot more than we're getting.
Let me address your concern about C-SPAN 2.
Right.
As a matter of fact, there were actually three channels that were taken off of the basic service. It was Oxygen, Shop NBC, which is your shopping channel, and C-SPAN 2. We have to pay programmers for the right to rebroadcast their channels. And in many of those, within those contractual agreements, we have to agree to a certain placement on our lineup. In these cases, we had the flexibility to place them on the digital lineup. The reason we did that is twofold. For every analog channel, and those were carried in analog, that takes up 6 megahertz of bandwidth. In that same bandwidth on a digital channel, we can get a dozen channels, or we could get 4 HD channels. So we were able to reclaim the bandwidth from those 4 channels and use that to give what our customers are asking for, which is more high-definition programming, and that's what we've done. Because we knew there would be a concern, we made it clear when we announced the change that any basic customer that needed a box from us could get one free for a year to still see those channels. Now, as you know, the technology in television has changed dramatically. You can't buy an analog TV anymore. They all have digital tuners. And a person with a digital tuner in their television can still see these channels. We do it what's called in the clear, okay? So the reason was to reclaim enough bandwidth to be able to give our customers what they want, which is high definition programming, high definition channels, and also to be able to increase the speed on our high speed data service Roadrunner, which we've increased threefold in the last couple of years. And that's an economic development tool for Alamance County. That's, you know, Roadrunner's the fastest stuff out there. And part of the reason it's fast is because we've reclaimed some of that bandwidth. And the hard truth is, Oxygen, Shop NBC, and C-SPAN 2, some of the lowest viewed channels on our system. So it was the least amount of disruption for the maximum amount of benefit.
Well, my last comment on, and I appreciate you coming, because I was in the dark, and I asked our county manager, two county managers ago, whatever happened to Time Warner, they used to come to us and ask for fee increase.
All we need was an invited.
Yeah, and, well, no, I'm talking about time.
Yeah. Well, Dave explained that very well.
Yeah, he explained that, but I appreciate you coming. And as far as the Burlington doing Channel 5.
Yes, sir.
I mean, we mail our DVDs of these meetings to Greensboro, don't we? No.
Scott? Sure.
Or they go to Charlotte, because it's definitely not Burlington.
Here's the deal. Both Burlington and Alamance County just record on a DVD and FedEx it now to Charlotte, and it's rebroadcast from Charlotte. So I would probably ask Mr. Yarborough to just send you a little note on that whole lash-up of how that works so you'd understand how that goes.
And the reason for that is, and I'm assuming that those don't have video quality issues. You're talking about the public service announcements. So I probably wasn't clear. Burlington operates their character generator, which is where you create the public service announcements that are in text. To make it as seamless as possible, the DVDs are sent to our main head end in Charlotte, and then that programming is piped back through fiber optic cable and put on Channel 5. That's just a more efficient and actually better looking way to do that than somebody in Burlington taking a DVD and putting it in a player and pressing play. It actually saves them time and money, and you get a better product that way. But the average day-to-day, you know, here's where you go to pay your water bill, you know, here's garbage collection days, here's how you contact the police department. That's done in Burlington. Somebody there is actually typing that into what's called a character generator. And, you know, those have different capabilities. I don't know if they're maximizing the capabilities of that unit or not.
I appreciate you coming.
I have
no more than I knew.
Yes, I have one question.
Yes, ma'am.
I've recently been getting a lot of emails to call Time Warner because you're going to take Channel 15 off. Is that?
And Channel 15 is, forgive me.
I just happen to have my charger.
I'm glad you do.
Good, thank you.
Would you sneak it to me?
I just flip channels. I don't know where they are. What is that?
Is that
Bronson?
15?
It's Hall River, same thing.
It's 45.
It's 45.
Oh, okay.
My 45.
All right.
My network.
Very good question. And I'm happy to say that that's been resolved. You may or may not realize, certainly if you've been reading the paper and watching those channels, you've seen that we have to negotiate retransmission consent rights with broadcasters. They have sort of a dual protection from the federal government. They can choose either what's called must carry, which means they say you have to carry us, or they can choose retransmission consent, which says you have to pay us or we won't let you carry us. And broadcasters over the last several years have seen that as a revenue stream, and they're charging us more and more and more for the privilege to carry their service. We have to have their permission. And Sinclair Broadcasting Group, who owns WXLV, which is ABC, and WMYV, which is Channel 45, was threatening as of December 31st to make us remove their channels. And we've been in negotiations with them to try to figure out a way that we can continue to carry those. And it was last week that a deal in principle was agreed to. It hasn't been signed or written yet, but I believe the danger of those channels going away has ended. And those happen all the time. Sometimes they make the news and sometimes they don't. What a lot of folks don't know is that every single one of those channels, except those PEG channels, which we pay for, we have to pay somebody for the right to carry it. And broadcasters in particular have a lot of negotiating power on that.
I emailed you several times, by the way.
And we've created a whole website about that and as much information as we have. It's a great question. Thank you for asking it.
Okay.
Can I address
sure.
comment, Mr. Yarbrough? Sure. I appreciate you being here. I will tell
yes,
you that back in 1999, we met with Time Warner Cable. I happened to be on the school board at the time. And you guys met with our internal audiovisual people and at no cost to the school system began televising our school board meetings on Channel 5. Now, they're not live, but they don't need to be live.
Right.
And I just want to thank you for that.
Yes,
that has been well received. And as a consumer, I will tell you I'm a very, very satisfied customer.
Thank you.
If meetings like this drag on, I can go home and push start over and go back to the beginning of the show I'm watching. And we, Christmas Eve, our family signed up for Elf for $1.99 in the house. And when it's time to get popcorn, we hit pause and went
that's
in the kitchen for a
feature.
While. There's nothing negative that I can say about Time Warner Cable.
That's part of the $380 million that we spent just last year in the Carolinas to improve our infrastructure, to offer start over and look back and all those things. It's a very capital intensive business, and that's what we spend our money on, is trying to give customers things. You know what my favorite is, and I bet I'll get a nod out of somebody. I love seeing the phone number pop up.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Caller ID on TV.
Very much so, but I personally appreciate what you're
doing. Thank you, sir, very much.
Any more questions?
No, I want to comment on what Tom said. Appreciate you guys doing
right.
what you do for
thank you
us
so much.
Because it does help the public that a lot of times can't come out to a meeting.
It's our privilege. We're part of this community and have been for decades, all the way back to when we used to have to come beg for a quarter.
Dave's a good beggar, though. I've been knowing Dave for a long time.
Yeah, Dave's a good man, and he really explained the Video Service Competition Act down to a T.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Thank all of you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, Dave. Okay. Is Mr. Bass here? There he comes. Next is our update on state smoking ban. Do you have that in here?
Madam Chairman, Commissioners, I've been asked to speak tonight to address an issue about the smoke-free restaurants and bars law in North Carolina. And I brought with me an entourage of folks who have been very instrumental in assuring that this law was implemented in Alamance County. First of all, I'd like to introduce Mr. Kent Tapscott, who is on the Board of Health. He is our pharmacist and chair of our Personal Health Services Committee. The other folks we have with me are is Carl Carroll, who is the Environmental Health Director, April Durr, who is Executive Director of Healthy Alamance, Laura Krasinski, who is the Tobacco Prevention Coordinator with the LME here at Alamance, Caswell LME, and Glenda Lennons, who is our Wellness Nurse and Health Promotion Coordinator at the Health Department. So these folks have been working very hard over the past year as the implementation of this law went into effect on January the 2nd of last year, and worked very hard in terms of getting background information and the local educational efforts in North Carolina, in Alamance County. And as you all see from the information that was provided in your packet, it has improved the air quality in the restaurants in North Carolina. We think that it has successfully reduced exposing secondhand smoke to folks who go into to restaurants and bars, which should lead to longer life expectancy. It is popular amongst the citizens of our state, as well as in Alamance County, and it creates a level playing field for the bars and restaurants statewide. So looking specifically at what it means in Alamance County is that there are over 500 facilities that are affected by this law. That includes food service facilities, motels, hotels, bars, and restaurants that have to comply. These facilities, as we've said, have received information prior to the law. There was a big public relations. You may remember seeing signs and billboards that have been put up. There are signages that appear in the restaurants, and as well as coasters and other materials that we're giving to the owners, as well as no smoking signs. And we also include in our environmental health webpage information to direct people to Smoke Free North Carolina. People who, and one of the things that goes with this is the enforcement of the rules. And so how do we find out about the violators? And there are three ways. They can either call the health department. Folks may also go on the website and complete an online form. And you can also call the North Carolina Care Line, and that is available 7 days a week from 7 in the morning to 11 o'clock at night. The law includes not only our restaurants, but also food service inspections, where the environmental health staff goes in and they do their food and lodging inspections. It also includes things like convenience stores, hotel common areas, and private for-profit clubs, as well as other lodging facilities, where in hotels and motels you can have up to 20% of the rooms designated as smoking, but they have to be the same rooms. They can't move around in terms of that. There are exceptions to the law, and that includes things like our tobacco, like a cigar bars, such as you have at JR's here in Burlington, as well as not-for-profit private clubs. The smoke-free club, what you have to do in terms of how it affects affected businesses is that they must post the no smoking signs. They must remove ashtrays, and folks are not allowed to smoke inside. You may step outside and smoke. And for folks, if we have repeat businesses who do not comply, there's a $200 per day fine that can be levied. And for smokers who would refuse to go outside and smoke, there can be a $50 fine, which would be enforced by local law enforcement for defying the law. The way that we have elected to do it in Alamance County in terms of our enforcement is, when our environmental health staff go out into the facilities, they make notes like they do for any other violation or any other items that they're looking for on their inspection sheet. And if they note violations within the facility, then they would inform the folks at the facility what they need to do to conform and comply with the law. We have taken a passive approach to enforcement, i.e., what we normally do is that we don't go out looking per se for violators. We wait for folks to report violations to us. Again, unless our environmental health folks are on the ground and they happen to see violations while they're in the facility. What would happen in the course of the violation would be that folks will get notice of what they need to do to comply. And if there's not compliance and there's a second violation, then we get a letter from me, which goes by certified mail. And of course, we obviously would get a receipt for that. And finally, these violations, we also would tell folks what it is that they're in violation of. So it's very clearly spelled out. In the course of what's happened in Alamance County over the course of this past year, there have been 41 complaints that have been reported on 17 facilities. Now, of these 17 facilities, only 4 are inspected by environmental health. So the others were folks who have non-food service and basically are bars, period. There were 5 facilities that had more than one complaint, and they were all bars. We had one facility that wasn't required, that was reported, but wasn't required to comply, that happened to be an internet sweepstakes business. And we all know what that is in terms of other issues. We had 3 facilities where no observation was observed, and we had 10 facilities that have a first violation. 1 has a second violation. We've had 1 that's had a third notice of violation, and fine is pending on that particular operation. So in total, it's estimated that we spent 10 hours of environmental health staff actually time on the ground in the facilities doing their inspections, exclusive of any paper time and travel related to that. So basically, that's where we are with the law in Alamance County. And if you all have any questions, I have our cadre of experts here who can address specific components of it.
Barry, I'm just curious, if there's a violator in a bar and the bar owner handles it, then that's not a violation?
No, sir.
Okay, so as long as the manager allows it.
Okay. That's correct. And again, we've taken the tack that we would only cite violations that are observed. And that will be when either Carl has been in a facility and the guy lit up when he was talking to him. So, I mean, that kind of a... yeah, so that was obviously, that was a violation. But the point being is, we have to actually see the violation occurring before folks are cited. So I've taken that approach.
How many citations have been written?
To...
or fines?
We've only had one particular person who was sent a notice of violation of fine, and they elected not to, they've elected to ignore it, and I defer to counsel on that in terms of that particular case.
One in Alamance County?
Yes, sir.
I've seen on TV this new cigarette. Can you address that? And what kind of smoke?
The electric?
I don't know. I quit smoking in 89, so thank goodness.
That isn't covered by the law.
I saw that. So would that still be?
That would not be a violation because it isn't covered. That has been a question that has come up.
Because there's no tobacco.
That is correct. It's an electronic something, but there, you know, there has been discussion.
I don't want to puff on it, but I mean,
For those that do, they can puff on that wherever. And it's at this point, we've been asked like to discourage folks being, but legally they can.
I don't think this issue is going to go away. I think, as a matter of fact, it's going to probably get some more attention, especially with the new legislature. See, this law was approved by basically Democrats. Just to be blunt about it, to show it was a vote in Raleigh, and the majority of the people who voted this law should go into play with the exemptions that you stated were Democrats, basically, and Republicans basically voted against it. So I think you're going to see some turnaround on this, possibly. Yes Magazine did in Greensboro. This is the latest copy, where there's smoke, and it shows an ashtray with cigarette burning, and it, there's a guy in Greensboro challenging this. Well, I don't think he's winning the case, but now I asked our county manager to ask Clyde, the judge in Pitt County that ruled it was unconstitutional, what type of judge was he to start with?
District Court Judge Dr. Morrow in Pitt County elected to proceed to prosecute violating the ordinance and seek fines in district courts.
Now, I'm talking about the judge that said the law was unconstitutional. That's not what we're talking about?
In Greenville.
Well, there was a judge in Guilford County. Now, he's a Superior Court judge.
Yeah, that's on the country club.
In that case, it's a declaratory judgment action for our owner challenging the constitutionality of the law.
That's in Guilford?
That's in Guilford.
Okay, now I'm talking about in Pitt.
Pitt, it's before the Court of Appeals.
Is that where the judge said that the law was unconstitutional?
Yes. Okay. It's a district court judge. It can.
District court judge. So I believe it's going to get interesting before it gets...
Well, wasn't it Raleigh that just introduced someone to...
Can't you smoke outdoors?
Can't smoke in a greenway?
Yeah. Park.
That one's big.
Yeah, I think that's going too far.
That was just a discussion. And we're not there.
Any more questions for Mr. Bass?
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, entourage.
All right. They're good folks to have with you.
All right.
Very good.
Okay. Well, Mr. Massey, if you want to go on to the next one, it's your budget amendment 69 and 70.
Yes, ma'am. The first one you have before you is for $2,150. And this is a grant we had also received last year from the Office of Women's Health. And specifically, these funds are used for a specific event, and it's for ladies and like their daughters, granddaughters, nieces, other females, and it's specifically, it's like Girls Night Out, and there's a collaborative that's done between the Health Department, the Women's Resource Center, and ARMC, and they do a one-night event. Most of the funds will be used to secure a speaker, as well as the public information and trying to get the word out about the event. Be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Any questions on that one? If not, do I hear a motion we approve this amendment?
So moved. So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All in favor say aye. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Next one is 70.
And the next item is a $24,939 grant that we receive from the March of Dimes. And this specifically is working towards our Centering Pregnancy grant. And what we will be doing is to acquire a program coordinator for this particular activity. Again, this will be under contract. This will also and help us to expand to four more groups that we'll be running through our pregnancy, the Centering Pregnancy Group. One of the things we want to do is to achieve accreditation for the services that we provide, and this would help us to acquire that, as well as other items to support this evidence-based practice. It will also help us work with our evaluation to try to look at the outcomes, you know, of the ladies who are going through this. How are their comparative outcomes to our other groups, as well as looking to for better birth outcomes for the participants, and trying to provide more educational information to this particular group. So this will enhance our pregnancy.
Any questions with Mr. Bass?
I'll make a motion. We move to
have a motion then on the floor.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed likewise.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate your
support. Thank you, Mr. Bass.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next on our agenda is Susan Osborne.
Yes.
Social Services.
Good evening.
Hello.
Good evening. I have a large budget amendment. This is a couple times a year we try to catch up the allocations and that we receive at Social Services. Throughout the year, we receive different allocations. For example, just last week, we received some more energy funds of $149,000. So this is catching up those appropriations and revenues. We did meet with Craig and Amy to discuss whether they had any questions. The net result of this is an increase of $451,000 in revenues. I'll be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Anybody got any questions?
None of that's county, right?
These are our allocations from the state and federal government.
Are there any questions? And I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
I have a motion to accept the budget amendment. I need a second. I have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, next is the hazardous mitigation plan. Hello.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, how y'all doing tonight? Good. You may recall I came back in January of last year and presented the proposed hazardous mitigation plan to the county that we were working on. The plan is good every 5 years. The first one that was put into effect was in 2005, and of course it came up in 2010. I don't know whether it's better to say we spent, I don't know how to, whether we spent hours or months, but it's literally taken from January to through October, 1st of November, back and forth between the county and FEMA and the county and the state. December the 2nd, our office got word that the county hazardous mitigation plan had been approved. You know, where do we go from here with that? It's kind of a twofold step. The first step, talking with the people from North Carolina EM Emergency Management, our first step is to get the county commissioners to adopt the plan. Once that's in, and that puts it in place, the second step will be for our office. We will go out to all the municipalities, to their boards, present the same plan, get their signature, put it all together, and y'all will get the final copy with all with the town of Elon, Mebane, Green Level, Alamance. The city of Burlington came on this time, as you know. The city of Graham came on. All of them came on, yes, ma'am. The state looked at it as better to have 100 counties in North Carolina. It's better to have 100 plans than 100 counties and 250, 300 plans.
Municipalities.
Right.
Yeah.
Our office will review this plan annually, every year, or if there's something that happens here in the county, like either man-made or natural disaster comes through, our office will be required to pull this plan out and go through it and review it. We've already gotten word that probably in 2015 it's going to change again. Hopefully it's going to be simpler. We actually went through what they call a crosswalk, and we went through it. I think David and I went through it about five times, back and forth, just changing stuff on it. And I know I'm not going to bore you to death with all the minute stuff in it, but the plan has been approved. The biggest thing that we need is, of course, y'all's adoption to it. And and then move forward from there on it.
Now, it's very informative.
It's long and drawn out.
I can't tell you
out.
I read every word in it, but
yeah, and it's,
I have read a lot of it. And
I mean, we had to deal with tsunamis.
Statistics.
You know, how are we going to handle tsunamis in Alamance County? How are we going to handle mudslides in Alamance County?
It's not as bad as coming here. We got
we better be running.
You're
right. But it does address a lot. I mean,
right.
If it's there, we've got to look at it. I mean, wildfire, you know, hurricane, tornadoes, riot, terrorism, you name it. We've got to be able to, and I'll also point out that this plan will work hand in hand with Alamance County, our COOP plan, and our EOP plan, Emergency Operations Plan. So it all works together. The COOP plan is basically where if, you know, a disaster takes place here in Alamance County, our office, Emergency Management, we can grab it off the shelf and say, okay, here's how to get started. You know, how do we deal with this, you know, this earthquake? You know. And hopefully keep everything going as smoothly as we can.
And we are on a fault line, by the way.
We are on a fault line. You are right. But like I said, one good thing was the city of Burlington came on, the city of Graham came on, and we've enjoyed working with them and the numerous meetings that we've had and we've had to put together with them. So I think when it's all said and done, it's going to be, hopefully next time, in 5 years, it's going to be easier, I hope. So, but like I said, I'll be glad to try to answer any questions on it if you've got any questions on it.
I got one kind of a question on the floodplain maps and stuff. Now, are you working with Bruce to keep that updated?
Yes, sir. We are.
So
we're trying to
inform when you look at it to buy. You can look at that.
Right, yes, sir. In fact, I think we've even worked a little bit with Ricky.
Okay.
I know Ricky has said that they can make overlay maps where we can, you know, overlay,
gives people the awareness of if
right.
they're in a flood-prone area
right.
or whatever,
yes,
or looking to buy there.
That is correct.
Well, that's one of the questions on the offer to purchase. Is this in a floodplain?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And upgrading our maps will definitely help
right.
that.
Right.
I know Ricky and their staff, they've helped us several times with that. Produce maps and things for us, so it does work out pretty good.
Any more questions? If not, do I hear a motion? We accept the resolution adopting the Alamance County Hazard Mitigation Plan. Have a motion. And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, all likewise. No.
I appreciate all that hard work.
Oh, I'm telling you, it's wonderful.
I hope we don't need it, but that's right. That's one of the things we don't have to find out if it works. As soon as we get through it, that sounds great. We will sign it. Bill won't sign it before we start it.
I told him just wait till we.
It's now official. You can sign.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah, he was ready. Okay, the next thing on here is Recreation and Parks Grants. Brian Haygood.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening to request permission from the board to apply for funds to acquire approximately 41 acres of property, which is a portion of a 100-acre total tract in the Cane Mountain Range in southwest Alamance County. The sources that our department is proposing to apply to for these funds are the North Carolina Recreational Trail Program Fund, which is actually federal highway money, so it comes from the federal government to the state of North Carolina, who then uses it, among other things. They have some requirements to invest in trails, greenways, other alternative forms of transportation. And we also are asking to apply for monies from the North Carolina Clean Water Management Trust Fund. Now, the Clean Water Management Trust Fund, we've applied to them before. We've had successful grants, and we've had some that were turned down. That's a fund that receives money from the General Assembly, from a direct appropriation primarily for water quality preservation. However, we've applied to this fund before. Many of our parks have water or some type of form of water on them, and we found them to be interested in funding our projects, and they do not preclude properties for park use. Now, we're asking you to allow us to apply for money to buy 41 acres out of a 100-acre total. If we are successful, if you allow us to apply, and we're successful and we get the money we're asking for from these two funds, our intent would be then, if you allow us, to apply for part of monies in 2012 to try to buy the rest of the property, what would we, in essence, would be doing is taking the grant monies that we get from Clean Water and Recreational Trails. Part if requires a match in order to apply, we would try to use the funds, if we're successful, to then in 2012 go after part of grant to buy the remainder of the property. At this time, though, we haven't bought any land. We're under no commitment at this time to buy any of it at all. The goal from this project would be to create a passive recreation facility atop the Cane Mountain Range, which, if I'm sure you're familiar with Bass Mountain and Cane Mountains down in the Sylvan Snow Camp area. It's a very unique geological feature to the county. This particular tract has some pretty astounding views, beautiful woodlands, abundant wildlife, and creeks also. We have not, as a department, come up with a specific use of the property. However, if whatever use would be planned for it, we would certainly be supportive of keeping it a low-impact use. That, one, would keep the cost of development down as low as we could. Two, these funding sources, they're going to require that development that we do be low-impact. Clean Water Grant, we're not going to be able to go in and do just any type of use. It would have to be very passive. The neighbors of this property include YMCA Camp Frontier, and they also include the Three College Observatory, which is located down off Thompson Mill Road. Three College Observatory is run by UNC Greensboro, but also North Carolina A&T and Guilford College have a hand in its operations. Both of these entities, the Observatory and YMCA Camp Frontier, are very supportive of this effort. The Observatory in particular, it's one of the largest observatories in the southeastern United States, and they're very eager to see if this property could be conserved to prevent any light pollution that may, you know, hamper their use of the telescope. We've run this project before the Parks Commission. They've reviewed this plan. They have voted to recommend that the Board of Commissioners give us permission to apply for these grants, just these grants only, to see if we can get funds from Clean Water and the Rec Trails program to buy this 41-acre piece. So I'm coming to you tonight with their consent and consensus to ask if you would be in support of us applying for these funds and to answer any questions that that you may have.
How much revenue is that going to take out of the county if we I just have a problem with taking federal money and buying a piece of property like that. You know, we don't need it for recreation. We've got more recreation than we can afford now. I just think it's a mistake to do it.
Well, the federal money that comes to the state, and I'm not an expert on federal highway funds and wouldn't play to be. However, the state, from my understanding, is required to spend some percentage of the money they receive from the feds to do things like this, to do trail work, to buy properties to be used specifically for trails, to buy properties to be used for paddle trails or greenways. I think, if I understand right, it's a function of the federal highway money that requires the state to invest in alternative forms of transportation. So when we looked at this piece of property, knowing that the county currently has no money set aside to do anything like this, we don't have any funds in hand to do any property acquisition for any reason, we had to look at the property, the 100-acre tract, and say, of this 100 acres, what might we be able to buy with different pots of money? We looked at RTP, which is the federal highway money, we're proposing a trail that will connect Camp Frontier to the observatory. And we hope that RTP would find that to be acceptable. They may not, but we would hope so. Then they would buy that part of land, which is about 10 acres, that it would be required linear to make that connection. But I'm not sure how it would affect money specifically budgeted for Alamance County for road work. This money, once received by the state, it wouldn't be able to be spent on road work anyway. That is my understanding. But, you know, again, for further details on that, it might be better to talk with DOT about what else they spend the highway money for.
Have you run any cost estimates once you get this as to what it just takes to keep up and look after this kind of a project?
Based on what we're doing currently at Shallow Ford and at some of the parks like Great Bend Park at Glencoe, as long as you keep the development down to a minimum, which we would be looking at trails, picnic areas at this site, if you don't put buildings, if you don't put, large enclosed shelters, the cost is actually pretty low. You're talking about some cost for mowing a parking area, and usually we have to put in at least one street light, to light the parking area, and I believe at Shallow Ford we put a well in, so we have power there for that. Again, knowing the county's desire to keep costs low for park operations, I can't imagine that we would be looking at doing anything beyond that level of development. But on an annual basis, I'm afraid I wouldn't be able to give you an exact cost estimate for it, but it would be.
Have you had any interest from outside groups? Like, I know you did at Shallow Ford, you had Boy Scouts, there's different groups that helped you in working on that. Have you had any interest with thinking about this project?
Well, with this project, the funds we're going after right now would be, our hope really is to get funded and then go after the part of grant to do the rest. If we get the monies that we apply for currently, the only commitment we're promising to do is to build a trail from Camp Frontier to the Three College Observatory. That's it. In fact, that may even be as far as it went if we weren't able to, you know, to get any other funds from Partif or anyone else. Now, I would feel pretty certain, based on the trail work that our department has done over the past couple of years, we would be able to put that in, and I'm sure we'd be able to solicit help from scouts and some of our volunteer groups. But if you allow us to apply, and we do so, and we're funded at the levels that we're requesting from these two organizations, and we go for the Partif grant, trying to use these funds as a match, at that point, we would have to go through some public hearings and some focus group meetings with the community and talk about what might be able to go in there. I could foresee, and I'm not suggesting uses for it, either additional hiking trails or perhaps some type of biking, mountain bike type facility, or maybe some additional equestrian trails. What, from our point of view, we would want to set a cap on it and say, listen, we want to limit the operating costs. So we would want to talk to the public about what they may want up there. But, you know, with the idea in mind that we would want to keep the development costs low and the operating low, too.
And it's totally undeveloped now, right?
That's correct.
Nothing on it.
Is the land on the market, I mean, to be bought right now, or is it just something that...
This opportunity came about as we were working on some of our trail work. It was brought to our attention that this property is, owner is Bass Mountain Properties, LLC. We're interested in selling it, and it was... Because of its location, that's really one of the main reasons I'm here with you tonight. Because it's up in the mountain range down there with some just spectacular views, and it's a very pretty place. Obviously, we investigated it to see, is it something that, you know, we would be interested in? Is there high rec value there? We certainly feel that it is. So it's appropriate for me to bring it to you and say this is an opportunity for us to try to pursue. Again, you know, our pattern has been over the past 4 or 5 years, any of these property acquisitions, we've really tried to do it with as little direct cost to the county as possible, even with the development, by either the type of development, keeping it very, very minimal, or finding other funds to help us develop it.
Talk to us about the match scenario you're mentioning.
What we would do, Partif would be the next step if we were funded here. Partif requires at least they require a 50% match in order to get funds from them. But they do, they would recommend
dollar figures on this 50%.
The property has been appraised at $8,000 per acre.
Right. By whom?
State certified general appraiser. I'm afraid I don't remember.
So, but it's there. Not just excuse me, Tim, it's not just the asking price.
That's been determined by an appraiser to be the market value for the property. So what we would like to do, now again, please let me reiterate, we're not under any obligations at this time or any contracts to buy any of this land. But we want to use that dollar figure as a basis to apply for funds from Clean Water and from RTP, which would be a total of 41 acres. We don't know what we'll be awarded. Clean Water doesn't always give you exactly what you ask for. They may think that's more than they are interested in investing at this site. They may have so many demands on them that this becomes a lower priority project and we get absolutely nothing, or we get some percentage of what we ask for from both these funding agencies, frankly. Once we get anything, if we get any money from either one of these two funding sources, I'm going to be coming back to you and to the county manager to report what's happened. This is the amount of funds that we have. We may be going back to the table with the property owners. We may be buying a little less property than we thought. But if it goes the way we would hope it would go, we would try to use this money, the funds that we do get from these two organizations, as a match for Partif, which you can do. They're separate funding agencies than the Parks and Rec Trust Fund. So we would, the idea is to eventually acquire the entire 100-acre tract, but to do it in a way where we get funds from Clean Water and RTP to buy what they consider, they would consider buying, and then use that as a match to go to Partif and say, okay, we have in hand X number of dollars, whatever it is, that they fund us at, to go to Partif and ask for the remainder to buy the rest. And again, if you give us permission to apply for these two tonight, we will do so. If we are funded at all, I'm going to be coming back to Mr. Honeycutt and reporting to him, saying, "Okay, this is what we were. This is the level we were funded at. You know, how should we proceed now?" Which would include possibly back to the property owners to talk, or coming to you saying, "We would like to now apply for Partif, using this money as a match to buy the rest of."
What are the odds, or the worst case scenario, that you're going to come here and ask us to take care of the difference?
I would tell you that, because of the uniqueness of the property, and because I think the way the county's growing, and that part of our mission as a department is to provide these type of opportunities for the future of the county, even if we were not funded at all, or needed additional funds to make up the match to buy the rest of the property, I would certainly go to the manager and explain to him that that's what has happened, and give you the opportunity, not me, to say no. You may not choose to do that. And I understand, you know, I've sat through some of the reports here tonight that you also have sat through, and I understand the situation the county finds itself in. However, I think that's part of my responsibility as the department head, is to bring it to you and say, this is an opportunity. If this isn't the time, because, you know, you have to fund it yourself, that's a decision the board would have to make. However, I certainly couldn't guarantee these grants will be funded. I would never do that, but we always, as a department, make our best effort to try to find funds from outside to make these opportunities realize themselves for the county residents. So.
But if you had to come to us and ask us for money, and we said no, a majority of us said no, the deal just falls through, right?
That's right.
Okay.
End of the deal.
Right. Not to belabor this, but let's say you commit and receive the funding for the 41 acres. Is there an option in place where the seller will hold the other 59, or does it become on the market for anybody to buy and, oh, hey, we're going to buy this because it's going to be next to this wonderful trail?
That's a great question. At this time, there's nothing. But, again, we don't have any money in hand. So, you know, it's hard for us to expect a property owner to do anything as long as we don't have any actual funds in hand. Once, if these are funded, then I expect we would want to talk with the property owner at that time.
It's our understanding the property owner is a motivated seller. And if we did get the initial grant funding, we would go back to them and be, you know, that to be a conditional purchase, is that they would have to hold that as an option so we could apply for the Partif funding.
Okay.
Right.
And what's the second type funding you said? And I'm just not familiar with
it. Partif. It's North Carolina Parks and Recreation Trust Fund. And we've had success with that grant, and we've been denied with that grant too. But it does require a 50% match, and it does require within 5 years it be developed. Again, I think if you hold the development to a very low amount, a lot of it are things that our department can do ourselves. We've done that as Mr. Boswell saw up at Shallow Ford. Again, I say ourselves. Don't let me mislead you. There was a lot of volunteer work put in to building that place up there. So, but we certainly understand the value in providing the county resident with a place to recreate that doesn't cost the county much to build or a tremendous amount to upkeep or operate. And, you know, that's kind of become one of our mission with these properties to do. So,
Brian, how close is that to Cedar Rock? How many miles away, you think?
It's probably 6 to 7 miles as the crows fly southwest.
And is it close to the Bass Mountain Park, the music park that was over there?
Yes. Okay. I'm not
probably right behind it, isn't it?
Yes,
I believe so. Camp Frontier is near.
Yes. Yeah,
but I've never been to Camp Frontier. So.
Oh, it's a beautiful sight.
But,
it really is a beautiful
sight. And, you know, the people down in that area, they have very little recreation. You know, we've discussed that as far as Eli Whitney Gym is concerned. You know, if we took that away, I don't have a problem with applying for the grants for that myself, because, you know, I mean, we're talking about Sylvan, and they're so far away from us, you know, that they have to drive 13 miles to get to a doctor. And I just feel like that this may be a good incentive.
I think it's a benefit for the Southern county Alamance. As a whole.
Well, as I say, I think the unique geological feature that it is would be an.
Well, it's not going to cost us any money. I have no problem.
And that's our effort is to keep that from happening.
Madam Chair, if you would, I'll entertain a motion that we proceed on to do this.
I have a motion on the floor. I need a second.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
That observatory's best kept secret. I don't know that it's the best kept. I mean, we should keep it secret. I went out there when the Hale-Bopp Comet came through years ago, and it was stunning to see the people that were standing in line to go through that.
Well, we've had, and I won't keep you any longer, but we have had numerous conversations with the staff there, and they're very excited about this opportunity. I think that they would be very interested in some programmatic use of, if this panned out, of the property, as well in conjunction with the observatory. So we're hopeful about it, and I appreciate your confidence. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Insurance committee recommendation for renewal of employee health clinic. Sherry Hook. Thank you.
Good evening.
Hello.
I am here tonight to talk about the employee health care clinic, it has been in operation now for 11 months, and believe it or not, it is time to make the decision about renewing that operation. So what I've got tonight is basically an overview of what has happened over the last 11 months with the clinic. It was opened in February of last year, and basically we opened this as a way to control our rising health care cost. From the employees' aspect, it was really to provide them a quick and easy access to medical care, hopefully to get them to the doctor quickly so that their problems don't escalate into something that requires very costly treatment. From our standpoint, it was a way for us to get a flat fee service or flat fee for these services instead of paying a per visit rate for a primary care, urgent care, or even emergency room visits. 11 months in operation. The way that we have looked at the cost of this clinic, and I think that you've got the spreadsheet there, is we have tracked our number of visits per month. We have put to the visit a cost that would have been associated with a visit to their primary care physician or an urgent care physician, and we're calling that our cost avoidance cost. And then we've also looked at what are some things that they've done in the office that has saved us some money, and then also some lab avoidance costs, which basically looking at if that lab work had been billed through their primary care physician versus being billed through ARMC and being able to take advantage of some of their discounts, just their volume discounts. And what we've got is comparing that to what we're getting billed on a monthly basis from ARMC. And we've come up with some significant savings over the 11 months of about $88,000. If you were to annualize that, it comes out to about $96,000. So we feel that there are some savings there. In addition, if you'll remember that when we signed on with the clinic, ARMC did agree to give us some additional discounts on our hospitalization end as well. And also the first year expenses that are shown in here include startup costs. So if we take the startup cost out and we add in the savings from the hospitalization, we're looking at potential savings about $139,000 for next year. So the savings are there for us. We did go through and survey employees to make sure, are you happy with this? They are happy with it. You know, a lot of them commented on what we were hoping we would accomplish, which was to get them in and out of the clinic quickly. A lot of them said, I can get over to the clinic, if I need a prescription, get that filled, and be back to work in an hour. And that's really helped us a lot. In addition, it's also been helpful for us to say to our employees when they're calling in sick, you know, there's a clinic you can go to, and we're hoping to see you back tomorrow. So that's been great as well. So I'm here tonight to give you that information, let you know that Alamance Regional has presented us with another contract. The contract is extremely similar to what we had last year. Of course, the startup costs are removed from that. There is just a slight increase of $1,000 in their administrative services. But again, we're still expecting the savings of around $139,000. So I am here tonight to say that the employee health or the health insurance committee has met, and they are recommending to the board that they approve the contract with Alamance Regional for another year of service of the clinic. And also to answer any questions that you might have.
I have a question.
Okay.
Is that open for retirees as well?
It is open to any employee or retiree that is on our WellPath program. Once they move over into Advantra, they're not eligible for it.
Retired from here.
Yeah. Sherry, are you finding or have you tried to figure, do we have like 20% of our covered folks using 80% of the services, or is it really spread out? I guess my question is, need to do any more advertising or pushing to let more people know about this?
I think the word of mouth advertising is what we've got, and I think that has been the biggest advertising for us, and I think employees are well aware of the services. When I did the surveys, the people that said they hadn't used the clinic, it was either because they had a very strong relationship with their primary care doctor or they hadn't been sick. So we didn't track number of repeat visitors, but in the survey that I did, I had 370 employees completed the survey, 314 had visited. And then also we did track physician visits, which I just got that today, from WellPath, and it's showing a 25% decrease in the amount of physician visits. What that's saying is they're not being billed through WellPath because they're going through the clinic. So I think, you know, the use is very high, about 173 visits a month, but we haven't tracked is that the same people going over and over. But if you look at the survey results, it looks like it's not the same people. It's spread out through the whole workforce.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Well, just a comment. I'm just so happy that this has worked out like it has, because mm-hmm. when we started last year with this, we had no idea. And I think probably some of the costs that aren't coming are like the ones where one of the employees can be there and be back. Because mm-hmm. like today, I was at the hospital, and Mr. Kearns had a full emergency room, and people had nowhere to go. And to have a place where we can put our employees and get
That's
them back
important.
To work,
yeah.
It's very important.
Does John want to comment about this or anything?
Are you just here to look at the video? I would say it's been very positive on our side. We're happy to work with the county and realize the improved access to care and the savings. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We appreciate that. Thank you.
Our staff's done a great job with it. Working with Sherry is a pleasure.
Any more questions?
Move we
have
make
a motion.
Motion
yes, sir.
Renew the contract
second.
As recommended.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed? Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Next is Mr. Honeycutt with the contract with Interstate Collections.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In front of you this evening, you have a proposed contract with Databax Interstate Credit Collections, debt set off collection services. What we're trying to do is to look at debts that are owed to the county that are greater than 5 years. And we are requesting that they work with us in those back collections for the tax department, EMS, and our dental clinic. Interstate Credit Collections has indicated their confidence in their ability to collect the old outstanding debts that are owed to the county. And again, by doing this and letting them focus on our older debts that are tougher to collect and tougher to find, we can focus on those newer debts that we do have that are less than 5 years. So hopefully this will free up some time for some of our collectors as well. And again, this proposed contract is based on contingency. It is a fee-based, and we will only have to pay off of what they collect.
Are we using them now?
No, ma'am.
Their rate's a little high, isn't it?
Well, it's because of the back. It's because of going back and past 5 years. You know, it's easy to – we're using EMS Source is probably what you're thinking
it, it
for.
It is, because theirs is like, 10%?
Our billing, yes, ma'am. You know, those current bills are fairly easy to collect. are easier to collect, but anything after 5 years, you get a lot of change of address and those type issues that make it much more difficult to
find. We don't pay them anything unless they collect.
Unless
them.
They find.
They bring money in. We
Angie Hutchins with Interstate is here this evening if you have any specific questions that you have. But again, this is just another tool that we thought we would look at to try to increase revenue, especially on those back debts that are owed to the county.
What is our statute on that, Clyde, as far as how far we can go back? I know you mentioned it one time before. I think.
10 years on property.
Yes.
10.
Before we send it to them, are we going to try to go through set off process and garnishment?
Yes,
and
sir.
All that before it even
yes,
gets
sir.
To them? And
yes,
then
sir.
It would only go to them after we try those things?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Well, I like it.
No. Angie, how many other counties are you working with? Can
right
you
now,
give us some?
Yes, we're working with Stokes, Haywood, Macon, and also Surrey EMS. We work just for that department.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing debt set off for those counties. Other counties we've been working with for since 1980.
Mm-hmm.
We work with. We're waiting for a contract for Gaston and Pitt. And we also work with Anson, Greenville, South Carolina, the EMS department, Guilford
okay.
County EMS, and a lot of other towns.
Okay.
And typically our collections, if they're over a year old, is typically 50%. And we give every county the same rate
okay.
at 25.
Okay. Yeah, because I was looking at EMS when we have theirs 10%. I'm like, okay, what is it?
First shot at the rabbit.
Right.
They're going after it after you know, chase yeah. that rabbit.
Okay.
And again, let me clarify, with respect to debt set off, they will do some debt set off on those 5 years in past. We will try to do that up till 5 years. You know, we will take every effort and every avenue that we have available to us for those first 5 years, you know, but after that it's difficult for us to find. And then this really becomes a collection agency, and it can affect your credit score if you do not pay that debt. That's one of the interesting things about them is that's the big stick that they do have, that it can affect your credit score.
Okay.
Do we keep a record of what we've done with each account that we're reflecting on here locally in-house?
I'm sure they do.
I'm going to support it, but the only downside is if anybody just sits back and says, oh, we're going to turn it over to collection agency in 6 months, so we don't need to fool with it any further. And, you know, because you do have some slough off there.
Yes, sir.
And as long as we don't slough off while we've got it before
yes, sir.
It gets to them, that's all I care about.
And again, that's what we're hoping for is, again, after the 5 years, we spend a lot
money.
Of time kind of spinning our wheels. I guess we'll let Interstate hopefully spend theirs, and then that will give us more time to focus on current.
How long have y'all been in business?
We've been in business since, actually, I was 1898.
Really?
Yeah.
Where's your home office?
We're in Winston-Salem.
That's
we
the home office?
Yes. It's the only office we have. We used to be the credit bureau of Winston-Salem, Equifax, and we sold that.
Okay.
And now we just focus on collections.
Yeah.
And I've been there for 25 years.
You're there, Paul Miller?
Yes.
What's he doing now?
I have no idea. He's for my time.
Well, see, he was in my time.
Yeah.
But I'm still here.
But we just focus on collections.
Okay. I knew Paul years ago.
Yeah. All right. So do I hear a motion that we
so
have second. A motion and a second? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay. Next is economic development. Mr. Craig Honeycutt, and that's for discussion.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. As the Board of Commissioners requested when we approved our chamber contract to look at economic development, there was a direction from this board to look at other counties, how they're currently doing economic development. Are they doing it in-house? Are they contracting with somebody? What is the staff? What is their funding levels? And we have tried to do that, and in front of you is a file of that and a chart. I do want to thank our planning department, Jason Martin and Jessica Hill, for all the work that they did. They're the ones that made those initial contacts and all the phone calls, and I do appreciate the work that they did. But I will read you the manager's recommendation. With respect to our ED program compared to other counties, funding-wise, we are one of the lowest contributors to economic development. The average ED spending by counties is $397,000, while we currently spend $122,500. I do believe that we receive a very good bang for our buck compared to many counties that fund it at a much higher level. However, in looking at the administration of the programs, we as a county do not have as much direct input on development activities that other separate ED commissions may have. Our ED committee is a chamber committee with representation on the committee other than governmental entities approved by the chamber. I believe that in order to have better input on ED functions in our county, we need to analyze the functions and structure of this committee with the chamber and also along with our current municipal partners to see if what we are being, see if we're being as efficient and effective as we can. Currently, the Chamber ED Committee meets quarterly, but with respect to the importance of economic development within our community, we need to be more active from a policy recommendation point to the Board of Commissioners and to our municipal partners. Even if no changes are implemented, it is important to review the functions of how economic development is done within our county to see if the current structure is meeting the needs of all of our partners involved. A periodic check-in and evaluation is always important, especially with such an important function of economic development and the impact that it has on all aspects of our county. And then again, thank you for allowing us to do this and to compile this information. The other counties that we contacted, they're also getting a copy of this. I think they're very interested as well. So it's been a good effort, I think, from everybody involved. But we wait your direction on how you would like us to proceed.
I've got one question. Where you said that our dump in was 122.5 and the average of the 20 we surveyed was 397.
Yes, sir.
Now, was that county money only with those counties, or was that municipal plus
county? County money only. Yes, sir. That we went back and rechecked that. After we had the initial report from, we started looking at it, we wanted to make sure that that was county dollars. So Jason and Jessica did call everybody back to verify the county dollars.
I'd say the Chamber of Alamance County is doing a good job.
Just from
we're getting the bargain for what we got and what we're getting,
no doubt,
for the price we're paying.
And I am on that board, doing, and it's very informative when I go to that meeting. Mm-hmm. I'm on the economic board, and very informative. And I go to the ribbon cuttings. Matter of fact, we have a tomorrow. Real quick, I'll throw it in here. We have a groundbreaking tomorrow at LabCorp. So.
At the York Court,
yes. And I'm with you, Bill. So, any other comments, questions? So, where do we want to go? Do we want to just continue on with the chamber? Do we need a motion on that?
It's contract, isn't it?
It's an annual contract. I think, and I do, ever since the contract has been approved, I hope you've been getting, seeing a copy of the monthly activity reports.
Mm-hmm.
That the Chamber's been very good about giving. I hope you also saw my quarterly report back to them, and hoping the board was agreeable what was in that as well. I do want to say I think we do have a very good working relationship. And I appreciate the work that Mac does as well.
Well, at this point, then, we just need to wait till the contract comes up and just continue on and just keep doing what you're doing. So we have a lot of ribbon cuttings going on as well. And how many have we done in the last couple of years, Mac? About 100?
We've probably been averaging about 40 or 45
a year. But I will say to you that those are actually above and beyond
the economic development.
The things
yes, sir.
That occur through the activities that our contract is about. So,
yep.
Not all economic activity is just the new industrial or
Exactly.
Businesses that come about, exactly. A lot of us, the small local businesses.
Which really helped us keep Alamance County going forward.
Well, we'd like to, and I think this is a positive question to ask. If we're only given $100,000+, what more do you think the other 20 are able to do with their extra money, you know, above and beyond what we give versus the average? What more do they do? And I mean that positively. I mean, what are we not getting that they're getting, for instance?
Well, some of them may be places where the public actually develops real estate and makes industrial parks available. I think, for example, the city of Monroe. Should I come up there, or is it okay to converse from back here? The city of Monroe
develops
and owns its own industrial parks. I think Gaston County may be involved in that a little bit. Some other places may do their own industrial park development. They own the site and do that. Some of them may have more staff, some of whom may employ someone to do calls on existing industry. They don't do anything else. They just get up every day and go make sure there's a connection between the government entity and the local business and industry citizens that are already there. A lot of it may be more extensive marketing in trade magazines or attending trade shows or these kind of things. Travel budgets and things may be a little larger. So it could be a combination of different things depending on what that particular county wants to be done and what's important to them. It can be a variety of things.
It's possible they've got less municipal money to deal with, too.
It's very possible that the county bears the whole brunt. I haven't seen the study to that extent. I just know from my colleagues that it usually falls to the county level. There, some cities may kick in a supportive role, but usually, if it's not an arrangement like we have here, it usually falls to the county in some major material way.
Most of these counties have a higher tax rate than us too. If you look at that column. Three of them, only three have a lower tax rate than our county. And I was looking at that too. So that brings in a little bit. What is it? Per 1 cent is 1.2 million. So you got to look. Some of them 72 cents on your. We'd be shot at sundown.
Don't say the word cheap.
I'm sorry. That's right. Okay.
She's a Democrat. She can get by with it.
That's all right. But you like
it. I'm picking.
I know.
I'm picking.
Okay, Matt. Well, I think everything's fine, and we'll just go on to the next issue at this point. Thank you. Which is a discussion of lease for skilled nursing facility. And Mr. Ben, are you ready with that?
I am.
Okay.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I'm here to talk about the county-owned nursing home at 779 Woody Drive. By way of background, the current lease with Kindred Healthcare expires on March 21st, 2011. We put out a request for proposals on December 3rd. It was published on December 9th. The bids were due by January 3rd and were opened on January 4th. We received four bids on this property. I believe there's a summary in your packet, but I'll go through them. They were from Grace Healthcare, from Medical Facilities of America, from Peak Resources, and from VMT Long-Term Care Management. You have the proposals there in front of you. Grace Healthcare was a triple net lease, $40,000 with a 3% increase and a 10-year term. With an option to address. I believe the gentleman earlier talked about the insurance requirements that they would meet whatever was considered industry standard, and then the additional proposal that they would like a right of first refusal if the property was sold. Medical Facilities of America was the second one. Their proposal was a little bit different in that they proposed to tear down the facility and build a new one with any discussion is should the commissioners elect to go with that proposal, that they would like further negotiations to determine what the rent would be and what the ownership interest in that would be. Peak Resources
sure.
Was third. They proposed a $38,000 a month rent with a 3% increase per year, a five-year term, and a $1,000 per occurrence insurance policy in a 3% aggregate amount. And they also propose to make about $350,000 in capital improvements to the facility. The final proposal was from VMT Long-Term Care Management. They proposed a $35,000 a month rent with a 2% annual increase and a 10-year lease with 2 5-year options, and that they would meet any insurance requirements. And they proposed to make about $200,000 in capital repairs, and mentioned something about they are a company that also operates a nursing school and would consider relocating that to Alamance County. Based on these proposals, the staff recommends Peak Resources. We feel that they have the best balance amongst the proposals. They're providing the most capital improvement to the facility, and all of the bidders agree that there are significant improvements that need to be made, especially the electrical system, which I don't believe has been significantly updated since the 70s and is just not sufficient to meet the demands of medicine in 2010 and going forward. And we feel it has the middle of the rent. It has the shortest term, which might allow us to renegotiate should there be substantial changes to the Medicare rates, and that this keeps operations moving with a minimal disruption to the 110 current residents.
The Peak is what, 3 years?
Peak is a five-year term with an option to renew for 5 years.
Okay.
Ben, I had asked, because I'm new, Craig to kind of convey, this property has to be owned by the county. What's the deal there?
No, the deal is that in 1976, the nursing home that is there was built with industrial bonds. And as a condition of the company that they created to manage all that, it reverted to the county after a 25-year lease. So in 2001, the county was able to regain full title of the property and was able to lease it to Vencor, who I believe became Kindred. That's the lease that's currently expiring now.
Okay. And it is a profitable venture for the county?
The county should get about $500,000 in revenue with minimal risk, provided the insurance requirements are met.
Thank you.
Are does our insurance pick up? I mean, I know those are pretty large amounts there, but would the counties pick up in case of negligence from us as property owner? I mean,
if there's a catastrophic loss, I'd have to look at our insurance, but I'm pretty sure it would pick up. This insurance we're talking about here is for a lawsuit against the tenant by a resident.
Okay.
Gotcha.
The name's the county. So we want to make sure they have adequate insurance to cover things like
that. Right.
But if a catastrophic, it would be probably like Pleasant Road with our insurance. Is that not right?
Flip over correct. To our.
Okay.
But our major concern was the patients that are there now. And keeping that facility open, mm-hmm. This is the proper best that we've been able to come up with.
Okay. Any more questions? Do we vote on this tonight?
We'd like, permission to enter into negotiations with Peak Resources, if that's who we'll go with, to present a completed lease at a later date.
Do I hear a motion?
So I'll make the motion of Peak. We go with Peak.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you. Okay. Next is county manager's report.
I have nothing to do with this. I did my first two.
So you're done?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, on the consent agenda, does anybody want to remove anything there?
I would like to pull 18B, 2.
18B,
2? Yeah, that's the trip to Tampa, Florida.
Oh, okay. That's just 18B.
There's a tube side to be. I don't know what this for.
It is.
I guess there's two requests by social.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. They're both social services.
Actually, you have three.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. No two is what I'm looking at.
Okay. Number two?
18B2.
Okay, mine aren't numbered, so which one is
mine
that?
Mine aren't, mine don't
That's
have a
That's the Sam
show. Okay, got it. Trip. I got it.
How many people are going on there?
Let's see. The, you know, SAMHSA requires a minimum of 10 folks to attend two out-of-state, two national conferences per year as a part of the award document, the cooperative agreement that we sign accepting the federal dollars. So we have a contingency that meets the requirements of the grant. We have our staff, our project director and our assistant project director. We have another child serving agency, which is the health department, which is one of the requirements. United Way and the Partnership for Children. We have key system partners, Mr. Honeycutt, our sheriff, a pediatrician, David Johnson, and our county commissioner, Linda Massey, who also serves on our Children's Executive Oversight Committee. And then our school system is a large partner in this work. And so in the absence, we had an agreement from our superintendent to join us, but in his absence, we've asked Jackie Cole.
How many is that? Just curious.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
So it's $13,000
of federal dollars.
Tax dollars.
Our federal grant.
Per person.
Tax dollars.
No, sir.
Okay, you said thousand. You're right. Okay, 10 times 10, 13,000.
Yeah. Kind of wish it had been shown that way as far as you got to figure it out. I'll look at this.
I'll be glad to redo it or do it differently in the future.
What I'd like to ask is, how many did you take to California? How many went to California? Ten? Ten went
out there?
The
grant requires a minimum of 10 partners.
Yeah, but how many went? Ten? Yeah, so California, now Florida. I'm going to vote against this. And, it's neither here nor there. It's just principle with me. But if you don't mind, would you please bring us a to-date, ever since we've received this grant, a total of what's been spent, what it's been spent for, and how many families or children that we've actually served.
Please. Sure, I can give you the number of families we've served, the number of trainings we've provided. I can give you that tonight. I brought that with me. Mm-hmm.
Well, you can, or you can just incorporate it with the dollars.
Okay, I'll be glad
I'd
to
like
do
to
that.
Just see how the money's.
I'll be glad to do that. And I'd like to tell you too that this goal has six. This grant has six goals. And they are to identify, link, and provide a broad array of services and supports for children birth to five who have multiple needs. It's to develop an organizational structure that supports ongoing delivery of evidence-based services to these families, achieve a system of sustainability beyond the grant period, and influence the community, the state, in the delivery of services for children zero to five, with the overall goal of reducing abuse and neglect for children, reducing foster care placements, improving school readiness and success, and increasing parental capacity for families to care for their children. And I want to share with you, and you'll see it in our budget request. I think Becky Loy talked about it tonight when she talked about $1.2 million savings in human services. But right now we're on a trend to have a 40% decrease in the cost of foster care here in Alamance County right now. And I think it's because of these efforts, it's because of our system of care, it's because of these collaboration with our community partners, and this training that we're going to is a piece of that as we go forward in improving outcomes for children. Hopefully keeping them out of chief deputies' jails and having a better outcome for children in school. And that really is our goal.
Do you feel like the other 90, and I guess we're going to debate this every year in a way, but
I'll be glad to.
Yeah, I would too. Our country is bankrupt, and this is one of the reasons, as far as I'm concerned, that I'm for certain grants, but I think other grants are giveaways, and you know, I could be wrong, but I understand there's only three counties that's got this, right, in the state of North Carolina.
That's right. Okay. That's because there's only three that have applied.
All right. What are the other 97 doing for the same people in need?
They're not.
Nothing?
Well, I think we're doing groundbreaking work, and we are, you know, we're providing an infrastructure for serving families in a different way that's being done in the other 97. And so I think it's groundbreaking work, and I think we're having positive outcomes.
That's good, and I understand your feelings, and I just would like to see the figures from the start, the day we got the money.
Well, she's got some of them. I'd like to hear those.
Well, I didn't bring the dollars tonight because I have
the number served.
I do have the number of children
I'd
we've
like
served.
To hear those numbers.
And you know, we the first year of our grant, this is the second year. The first year of the grant, we were required to be a planning year, not to serve families. The second year was our first year of serving families, and we were required to serve 100 children. We have today served over right at 200 children directly. And then we have served another 200 children in the trainings that we provide. We've trained 547 folks. We have five evidence-based practices that we're implementing into the county, into our mental health providers, our child care providers, and our folks who care for children and impact young children. So you can see the goal of our grant is not so much direct service as it is to build the infrastructure that will be here after the grant's gone. We really focus and really focus on trying to make this sustainable. And I'd like to read for you a couple. We just had a large site visit. We had six folks come to Alamance County and review our grant, our funding, our contracts, our progress. And their report, I'd be glad to share with you in its entirety, but their report focused on how we're using existing structures, how we're building sustainability, how we're using other funding sources other than the grant to focus on the sustainability of where we're going with improving outcomes for children, and we are particularly proud of that. So I'd be glad to answer any other questions that you have at this time, and I'd be glad to do a report of the finances.
I'd like to see it.
Be glad to.
I would like to make a comment. I went last year to Anaheim, and I'm going to tell you, we worked every single day from the morning time we got up. One day we even worked through lunch. They said, go get your lunch and bring it back, and we certainly did that. Of course, we went out to dinner at night, but other than that, we were in classes all day long, every single day, and we didn't miss either. We had different places we could go to. It's very rewarding. I've worked in DSS, I've worked in the health department, and I've seen these little children that are mentally in some form been treated bad or for some reason. I've seen a six-year-old that was strapped and took to Chapel Hill, a five-year-old too, and I know what this is about. So I have no problem with the SAMHSA grant. I think it's one of the best things that's ever happened to Alamance County.
Well, and just a note on that, it may cost today, and it is federal money and all that, but in the future, how much does it say to prevent what may be an outcome? Who can put a dollar on it?
Right. Well, that's, investment in our young children is the way we see it.
That's right. Okay. Any other questions? Since we pull that off, we will vote on that one at this point. On the out-of-state travel for social services, do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Okay. We have a motion to approve it.
Approve it.
I have a motion to approve. I'll need a second.
Second.
Okay, I have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay. It's passed. Okay, now the consent agenda. Anything else that anybody wants to pull off? Okay, if not, do I hear a motion? We accept the balance of the consent agenda.
So moved.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed?
I didn't say anything. I just said aye.
Okay. All right. Okay, now it's commissioners' comments.
I'll go to Tom's house and watch Time Warner. He's so happy with it.
Well, actually, we've got the opportunity to start over if we get there by 9:30 before it's over. I'd like to make a comment, Madam Chair. I meant to say this earlier, but I'd just like to compliment Amy Weaver and her staff. What Becky told us tonight was where it is, but how we got all that information, I think, is a tribute to the finance area. And in these days and times, for a governmental entity that has to keep track of funds coming here and there and allocated without having any exceptions, which is what Becky said, I think is commendable, and I think she deserves that recognition.
Amy's great.
Yeah, I agree.
I do have one other comment as commissioner. I don't know if you guys got the Department of Transportation letter. Mm-hmm. You did? Did y'all get this?
What is it?
Department of Transportation about the secondary road project?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Yeah. Well, if you got them, then I won't need to read them, because we did have one man that had sent me an email on it, and his road is on here. So, okay.
I got just one, Craig, and I went to the Piedmont Food and Agricultural Processing Steering Committee today, and it's set to be open April 15th. And for the folks out here that are in the agriculture, hopefully this thing will be a great success, and they'll be able to go down and add some value to their products as they take them out of the field.
Yeah. That's the truth.
Yep, it's in Orange. It's going to be in Orange County, set to open April 15th.
Got a lot of potential.
Okay. All right. Any other announcements? If not, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Don't get have a motion in the week. Second. On favor.
Second.
Adjourn. We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.